first text today. We're starting a new series on the wisdom texts. So our first is going to be, we're going to bookend Proverbs 31 and Proverbs 1. Proverbs 31, verse 10, begins with, "A woman of valor, who can find her? She is far more precious than jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does good and not harm all the days of her life. She seeks wool and flax and works with willing hands. She's like the ships of the merchants. She brings her food from afar. She rises while it is yet night and provides food for her household and tasks for her maidens. She considers a field and buys it. With the fruit of her hands, she plants a vineyard. She girds her loins with strength and makes her arms strong. She perceives that her merchandise is profitable. Her lamp does not go out at night. She puts her hands to the distaff and her hands hold the spindle. She opens her hand to the poor and reaches out her hands to the needy. She's not afraid to show. She's not afraid of snow for her household, for all of her household are clothed in scarlet. She makes herself coverings. Her clothing is fine linen and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sits among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them. She delivers girdles to the merchant. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she laughs at the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many women have done excellently, but few surpass them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her the fruits of her hands and let her works praise her in the gates." And if we go to the beginning of Proverbs, we try to imagine that the writer probably was saying something about the same thing in the beginning of the book and the end of the book. So let's see how the writer began. We're doing 1 through 7. Let's just do 1 through 7, or else this gets complicated. Okay. Your proverbs are like little lines, so after a while it just gets too many lines, you know? So, "The Proverbs of Solomon, son of David, king of Israel, that men may know wisdom and instruction, understand words of insight, receive instruction in wise dealing, righteousness, justice, and equity, that prudence may be given to the simple, knowledge and discretion to the youth. The wise man also may hear and increase in learning, and the man of understanding acquire skill to understand a proverb and a riddle, the words of the wise and their riddles. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction." We believe this to be the word of the Lord. So as a congregation this summer, in the summer I try so hard to say, you know, let's not have meetings as much as we can. You know, my dad has a rule that he gave me a few years ago that you should never have a meeting in the summer unless you're holding a hot dog or a beer. Which I thought, you know what, it's just a good rule. And so so we try to like dial it all down in the summer. But the truth is that the summer is when we prepare for the fall. And so there's always some things that we have to do, some business we have to do. And it turns out that our congregation, I feel like Leslie said this years and years ago, I repeat it all the time, that our congregation is the little congregation that never got the memo that they're a little congregation. And so we just do big things all the time. And so we have some big tasks that are set before us right now. The property team is working with a realtor, as you know, to sell 2 of our properties. And if you've ever sold properties, you know that it requires a lot of thought and trust and wisdom to do so. At the same time, the property team is working with the township on our site plan. And then they're also working out the details of what our new sanctuary will look like. They're making sure that whatever the new sanctuary is, it fits our needs, and it's going to serve us as a community, and then it will serve our larger community. And so this task also requires thought and trust and wisdom. And then the Wellness Center Board, along with the elders and the deacons, are considering a new program for the fall. It's an intentional, inclusive community. It's essentially a program that helps people who are different from one another become friends. And so this task requires a lot of conversation. It requires courage, I would say. It also requires some wisdom. That's not enough. The staffing team recently held interviews for an associate pastor. Now, this is a huge endeavor for us as a congregation because both of the parent churches that make up Grace have only known one pastor, right? So for us to say, we're going to add another pastor is a really big move for us. And we're adding that pastor with the hope that that pastor will help us grow spiritually while we build. It's a big deal, right? It's exciting, but it also requires a lot of thought because there's some unknowns for all of us. It feels a little scary, and it requires wisdom. Now, you'd think that that would be enough for the staffing team, but no, after they finish that task, they're going to have to fill the music director position, right? So we're grateful to have Vince for the summer, but the staffing team is going to be at it again to try to find someone for the fall. Now, that's not all. I mean, I could go on to the normal thing, right? Like I said, summertime is the time when we plan for the fall, so our Christian education team will be looking at curriculum and figuring out what should children learn and what should adults learn and what's our plan. We're going to pick all of those things and we'll schedule out teachers and all of that will happen. So in the work of church, right, there's always need for wisdom. In the work of church, there's always need for many voices. And we always joke, I mean, I hope you've heard jokes of Presbyterians joking about their committees, right? That we have committees for everything. And sometimes it seems annoying. Sometimes it seems like we're having a hard conversation. And then someone says, I think we should put it in committee, right? And like, let other people work on it. But when I think of committee, the truth is, committees help us find wisdom because committees have more than one voice at the table, right? Committees have multiple voices, and with many voices, then we hear many perspectives. And when we're able to hear different perspectives, we're beginning to get wisdom. That's true in church work. But I believe that it's also true in our own lives. Wisdom isn't found when we only listen to one opinion. For me, I tend to hold a lot of different thoughts in tension, especially when I'm working on something that requires wisdom, when I have a question that I don't know what the answer to, or when I'm going into something in life that I'm not sure what the right direction is. I try to hold a lot of different thoughts in tension, and I'm sure that you do too. And so I thought we would parse it out a little bit together, right? So the first, if you imagine, I'm sorry that you can't see a circle. It's supposed to be a circle like a table, like a round table, right? And so if you can imagine your mind as a committee, right? I know, it's kind of crazy, right? So, and if you're anything like me, which I think a lot of us are like this, the first voice to speak up and the first one to take a chair is the critic, right? I mean, that I know that I'm not the only one, right? And I also know that that's true, really true in church committees or any like other, not the one in my mind, but in other places, right? The critic is the first to speak, right? And here's the thing, the critic is often wise. The critic often has a good point. It just speaks too fast. It just, you know, like, right, you don't get a chance, right? You might come to that conclusion on your own, but the critic is just impatient. So the critic wants to make sure that we know all of the negative options. So it blurts them out very fast and furious, usually, right? And the truth is, I mean, I've experienced this, many people stop right there, right? Because the critic is loud and, like I said, fast and furious. And you think, oh, that's a lot of reasons. No, okay, the answer is no. Right? Because that actually feels right at the time, okay? We stop right there. Whatever the idea, whatever the question, this fast and furious opinion shuts down the discussion. So here's what I try to do in my moments of clarity, right? I put the critic in its place, right? The critic gets a chair. That's fair. As if I'm forming my own committee. It's not that the critic is wrong, right? The next one I add are like my faithful listeners, the people that I trust in my life. I start adding to my committee, right? Trusted friends. They get a seat on the committee in my mind. So I don't know about you, but many of my faithful listeners are actually in this room, right? And I know that I am a faithful listener in many of your lives. And that's a fantastic treasured position of being in church together. And if that's not, I hope find people in this room to be trusted partners with. There are people who are wise. There's another seat at the table that is held by what I call like the trust, the people who taught me stuff. right? And so there's that chair revolves. Like, it's not always the same person, right? It could be my mom some days. But a lot of times, it's whoever taught me about the subject at hand, right? So maybe it's a professor from seminary if I'm doing some biblical study. It could be someone who's taught me how to write, right? So someone who kind of knows something that I trust, and that's what's rattling around in my head. Sometimes we don't even know that that's another person because maybe we've known how to do it for so long, right? You don't think your dad's around when you're like fixing something because you forgot that you learned that so long ago, right? So I would give you names of mine, but I don't think that matters, right? Like, I have a mentor that's kind of one of the people that ends up showing up sometimes. I have a professor, right? So I'm sure you have different people that fill this seat in your life, in the committee in your mind. So for me, the next seat is my family, right? And when I say that, I mean like my small Scibienski clan, right? So Dan and Pete and Joe and Faith, and then even the little ones, right? Julia and Mateo, because they teach me how to love and be kind. Right? And they keep me honest. The Scibienski boys are like feverish readers, and so they're just smart and clever, and they make me have really good tight science, right? You can't have bad science in the Scibienski house, right? Like, so you gotta tighten that up or else people stop listening to you. So that's my family. Yours is different, but you have like that culture that's from your people that say, this is kind of how we do. This is what we do, you know? You don't, it's in one seat. It's not every seat, they don't get everything, but they get a say, you know? Whether you like it or not, they get a say, right? So, then what's next? Me, you get to be at the table, right? So you've started to collect these voices, right? These other opinions, perspectives. And so you get to be there, and you are the compilation of all of your experiences, what you think is right to do, right? And then the last one at the table, I want to argue, is this woman that's described in Proverbs 31. So her name in Hebrew is Da'at, and in Greek it's Sophia. That's the name for wisdom, right? The poem in Proverbs 31 is about the woman of valor, is how it's translated actually in Hebrew. Sometimes they translate it the good wife, which is a really horrible translation. I mean, I'm okay saying that, like, on its merit. It's a bad translation. And then I'll go off text and say, when you get a Bible and it has bad translations, the reason why that is because they don't think you'll buy the Bible that has it the other way. So the publisher actually thinks you and me, we, are stupid. And it bothers me. It really bothers me. Like, does that make sense? They think that if we go against tradition so much, people will, like, picket a translation of the Bible and not buy it. And so then they end up translating it the way they think you want it to hear. Rant is over. Okay. So, where am I? Proverbs 31 is about the woman of valor, right? This woman of valor is, the word valor is actually most often used in terms of warfare in the scriptures. And so if you think a bit about that word meaning brave or courageous or forceful is what it's talking about. Proverbs 31 is an acrostic poem, right? Which means that all the lines that we were reading in Hebrew start with a different letter of the alphabet, right? And when you write an acrostic poem, what you're trying to communicate is that this is comprehensive. Like, this says as much as I possibly can say on the subject. I'm going to say it A, B, C, D, right? You get it? So in this case, the woman of valor, as I read it, I'm trying to read between the lines, right? Because even in our translation, it made it sound like it was a woman with a husband. It makes it feel like that marital relationship. It sounds like she's trustworthy. She works hard outside of her home and inside of her home. Now she in this, she is Sophia, right? This person that's sitting at your table. This is all the things she is. She knows about things that are foreign to her, and she's able to provide for things near to her, for people near to her. She's wise with money. She works late. She's capable in her craft. She cares for those who are in need. She's prepared for the future. She's able to laugh. She's kind. She's not idle. She fears the Lord. That's Sophia. She sits at your table on a good day, right? On a clear day, I want her at the table. Wisdom. So Sophia gets a seat at the committee of my mind. that's trying, whatever committee is trying to figure something out, what I should do or what I should be. And the thing about committees is that it's always easier to do things on our own. Like, we all know that and we say it. It's easier to do things on our own, but it's rarely better that way. I'll say that again, because it's hard to believe. It is rarely better when you do something on your own. Wisdom is rarely found out when we just do it on our own. And so let's be honest, the critic isn't going to let us do it on our own, right? And so that means it's us and the critic that are a lot of times making all the decisions. And we don't let the other people around this table get a say. Listening for wisdom or making sure wisdom shows up takes time and it takes intention. And wisdom is often the last to speak. So like I said, today is the first Sunday of a new sermon series on wisdom. And so we're going to find out, who is this Sophia? What does she do? How does she work? What's her role in our spiritual lives? What does she have to do with God? And so I want to start by seeing how others in the Christian tradition have understood her. And so I have some pictures for you. They're artistic renditions, right? The first is an icon, a Ukrainian icon of Sophia. And if you see, the people standing underneath her are kind of all the saints. So she's like holding court, holding things together. And here's a depiction of Saint Sophia with her three martyred daughters, Faith, Hope, and Charity. Right? Not the most uplifting or positive image, but it certainly makes us think of how people were thinking of wisdom at the time when they created it. Here's Sophia, I love it, whispering in St. Peter of Canisius's ear, right? Almost like the good angel bad angel, they created Sophia as the whisper in an ear. And the next is a statue of Sophia at St. Celsius's library in Ephesus. And this one is an icon from Istanbul. Sophia is holding Jesus, right? Which is interesting too, where we put, where is the Sophia in relationship to God? This is what they were thinking at the time. And then this one is in my office, if you want to come look at it again. I love it because it's an androgynous being. You can't tell if it's male or female, but it's meant to be holy wisdom. So it's Sophia, but she's holding the world. There you have what people thought of Sophia. Sophia has been understood as a person, not an idea. I think that's what we understand from this. What would happen then to our search for wisdom if we stopped thinking of wisdom as an idea, but found her as a person? Wisdom is someone we could invite into the conversation in our lives, right? She could hold a seat at the table of our minds. What would happen if we considered her presence? What would happen if we considered that her presence and the opinion of God in our lives is really important, and so we didn't make decisions until we heard it? And I don't mean just our spiritual lives. I think sometimes we only think about God when it's about our faith or when we're doubting, right? Or in church meetings. But I mean every area of our life, right? In our relationships, in work, in classes, with our roommates, in our marriages, in our parenting, in our shopping, in our reading. If we invited Sophia as often as we invite a friend into the conversation, I wonder what might we begin to understand. So this act of inviting Sophia to the table is a way that I believe that we can take the beginning section of Proverbs seriously, right? The book begins by saying that the beginning of wisdom is the fear of God. Not being scared of God. Fear in this case means being in awe of God. To pay respect to God. To make sure God gets a say. That's fearing God. So God desires and deserves a prominent place in our thinking. God deserves a place at our committee. And we have this example of wisdom personified that clearly was looking for and seeking God's thoughts. And so might we invite her into our lives for conversation. And in so doing, might we find wisdom. Amen. We're going to reflect for a little while, and so it says it in your bulletin as well. This is where your origami, oh, it says windmills, could change it to butterflies. They look cooler. So I invite you a time of reflection, and so I ask you to consider the sermon. Is there an area in your life where you're seeking wisdom? Consider some of the things you were thinking about, maybe when I was speaking. And I'd ask you to write your prayer on your piece of origami paper. And we're going to turn all of them into butterflies, and we're going to hang them in the beginning in the front of the worship space over the course of the next 5 weeks. And so you can try to make your own butterfly. The instructions are on the cover. Or if you would prefer someone else to help you, then me and some other people are available during fellowship time who are not afraid of origami. They can help you with it. Or you can just fold the paper and put it in the offering plate, and then we'll make those into origami for you. And so as you write your prayer, I pray that Sophia, Holy Wisdom, would guide you in the way of righteousness. Let's reflect together.
Christ.
use for us in this time and place.
That though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we are called to be instruments of God's peace.
We believe in living, hoping, laughing, and enjoying the good of the earth.
We believe that people can change, and God keeps calling us to life and to a new world.
Let us turn our attention to giving thanks to God by sharing with one another. We see the gifts of God all around us. Many of them are the gifts we can share with others. As the offering plate is passed from hand to hand, consider the gifts you have in your life and ask God to reveal how you are to share those gifts. The usher may come forward to take today's offering.
Thank you.
not just listen to the critic and yourself, but you would invite faithful listeners and maybe your family or your place of origin, that you would hear also the voice of Sophia speaking wisdom to you. Might you go with the love of God before you, the grace of Christ all around you. Might you hear the voice of the Spirit that says, this is the way, walk in it.